discuss the effects of radiant energy on our sense organs.
No marks will be given for answers which do not go straight to the point. That's a good disclaimer in the start.
It's a great exam, actually. That's really cool.
You know, I'm gonna bet that it wasn't even a correct theory because they didn't even have, like, Boltzmann believe in atoms or anything, so...
Hey, so I have here with me an undergraduate physics exam from the University of Sydney from 1888. And I gave it to some 2019 physics students, also at the University of Sydney, to see if they could answer questions from 130 years ago. And here's how they did.
What is the law of gravitation? On what sort of proof may it be considered to rest?
That's a strange wording. But I love this question because in 1888, the concept of gravitation that we had was Newtonian. It was entirely Newton. This was before Einstein came along in 1905 and 1915. Actually, yeah, gravitation would have been 1915. That would have been the general theory rather than the special one. So the answer that we would give to this question now would lie entirely in, you know, curvature of space-time and geodesics and all these kind of things. It wouldn't... Yeah, like, we know a lot more about how the world works now than we did in 1888. So the answer we'd give to this question now, you know, the people who are marking it, would their mind would just be blown and they'd probably mark it wrong. I think that's kind of cool.
Discovered that the seat of the
electrical energy of a charge conductor is the dielectric rather than the conductor. So
the seat
of the electrical energy
what does that mean?
Of a charge conductor is the dielectric. Okay. I refuse to give a sketch.
You're not getting marks for that one.
I could draw a chair.
Draw a diagram and explain the action of an ordinary photographic camera. Why do we fail, as a rule, in attempting to take a photograph by gaslight?
Why do we fail, as a rule, in attempting to take a photograph by gaslight?
Well, I guess by now.
Yeah, but...
By gaslight.
What does it mean by gaslight?
And tell me to take a photo. I've never taken a photo by gaslight, so I can confirm that possibly you still fail to take photos by gaslight.
In 2019, we have CMOS sensors or CCD sensors. Basically, you know, some light, a photon of light hits a pixel and then creates some voltage and you convert that into an image. While in 1888, it was all done with... This would have been before film. It would have been probably like silver colloidal plates. I'm not actually an expert in early photography. What matters is that that sensor isn't particularly sensitive to light. You need a lot of light to hit it to expose it properly. So I guess this goes to the second part of the question. Why do we fail as a rule in taking photos by gaslight? Well, gaslight is relatively dim. It's probably not enough light to be able to, you know, take a decent photo of. As a tiny tangential side note, I love the fact that when you look at old photographs, everyone seems to be like really stern and not smiling. And the reason for that is because they had to take relatively long exposures. The film wasn't sensitive enough. So it's kind of hard to hold a smile for 30 seconds without it blurring out.
Oh, the reversible engine. Ooh. Carnot cycle, you said that was...
Here's a good one for you, Dan. A common steel yard is graduated on the assumption that its weight is Q and that the movable weight is W, both which assumptions are incorrect.
Sorry.
I know less than I started with at the beginning of the question.
is graduated... The words are throwing me. Graduated
what's,
on what's the assumption.
Yard? What's a steel yard?
What's an uncommon steel yard?
What's a common steel yard?
What is a magnet? How would you make one?
Atoms have electrons around them, and each electron, you can think of it as a tiny magnet with this property called spin, and it kind of points in a particular direction. And in normal materials like wood or, you know, yourself, all these spins are all in different directions, and so the net result is, you know, if you're measuring the magnetism, it's zero. But in special metals or other kinds of materials, you have a lot of these spins lining up, and when they line up, all these little tiny magnetic effects add on to one another.
How much of that would people know in 1888?
Oh, that's a great question. Well, because they wouldn't have quantum mechanics. I don't think they would have the concept of spin. So how would an 1888 student answer this question? I guess they would say it's a hunk of metal with these particular properties that was Faraday? No, Faraday was 20th century?
Faraday's name is in some of these questions.
So I guess that then makes sense of the how would you make one? Because that would take advantage, so they would have a concept of electromagnetism, the kind of unification of electricity and magnetism. And so you could just simply run current through a wire, and that produces a magnetic field.
Give an account of the theory of the ordinary Bell telephone and explain as fully as possible how you would make one.
Fully as possible, how you'd make one.
How you would make one. Yeah, the theory of the ordinary Bell telephone. They didn't even have it.
They're very big into the experiment.
I've never even seen a telephone.
What? Please stop.
But first, we should describe Nicholson's hydrometer.
What?
Everyone is familiar with Nicholson's hydrometer.
Yeah, me.